This is a reading from Muscle and a Shovel by Michael Shank. Chapter 10. It's titled, Just Don't Drink the Kool-Aid. And the subtitle says, Christmas Almost Here. We're on page 76 of the book. My philosophy is this. Any denomination that claims exclusivity to heaven is probably some kind of cult, he said as he looked over at me over the top of his crossed feet, which were propped up on one of the messiest desks I had ever seen. The Lutheran minister was interesting, to say the least. He was a guy in his early 50s, and he looked the part of the quintessential professor. He had wire-rimmed glasses, a graying beard, a ratty corduroy jacket with patches on the elbows, and a pipe hanging out of one corner of his mouth. His office was an eclectic blend of Victorian antiques, tribal art collected from African missionary trips, stacks of old issues of Scientific American, newspapers strewn all over the place, secular paperback novels on the rear bookshelf, hundreds of religious hardbacks on the opposite wall, a large potted ficus tree, missing half of its leaves, in the far corner. The office was filled with the smell of pipe smoke mixed with something else. Mothballs, maybe? I had just finished replacing a computer board in the church's electrostatic stencil imager and had asked to talk with him about the Bible. It was interesting that he gave me more time than my own pastor, and I had not contributed one dime to his church. This particular Lutheran church happened to be one of the largest Lutheran churches in the Nashville area. The Reverend, or whatever the Lutheran pastors like to be called, had just finished a phone call in his office. I had heard him over the phone say, It's BYB night, right? Bring your own beer? Lutherans drink? Huh, I like to drink. I liked Lutherans immediately. Baptists never drink alcohol. And that denomination, the Lutheran Reverend was talking about Randall's church, totally dismisses John 3:16, said the minister. This was a point I had totally forgotten. Yeah, I jumped in. That's right, I'd forgotten about that verse. John 3:16 was a verse that had been branded into my brain at an early age during Sunday school. I wanted to impress him with my Bible knowledge, so I quoted, For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. It rolled off my tongue. He had to be impressed. The Lutheran Reverend puffed up his pipe. He was not about to be outdone by some young computer technician. He ignored my quote. You realize, Mike, that Jesus said in John 15:5 that he is the vine and the various denominations are the branches. No. My mouth dropped open. I did not know that verse. I thanked him for his time and left his office thrilled with this new knowledge. I had a visual in my mind of Christ being like the trunk of a tree and the branches coming out from him being all of the different denominations. And Randall's church? Maybe it was some type of cult. But knowing Randall the way I did, the cult thing just did not add up. Randall believed in the Bible. He supported every belief with his Bible. Driving back to the office gave me time to wind down and think. At least the Lutheran pastor remembered my name, I mulled. Points for him. All right, I mentally summarized. Number one, John 3:16. The Lutheran minister said that Randall's church disregards that verse. Number two, John 15:5 says that Jesus is the vine and denominations are the branches. And three, the reverend said that groups who claimed exclusivity to heaven were probably cults. I was headed back to OSI determined to find Randall. I was a man on a mission. Randall was nowhere to be found. I called the office switchboard and had him paged. Nothing. I was sitting at my desk, smoking a cigarette when Larry came in. He sat down at his desk and said, Those things are disgusting, while pointing at the Marlboro in my hand. Where's Randall? I turned a deaf ear on his anti-smoking comment. Larry responded, "I heard he's out sick today." Later that evening, Janetta and I had an excellent dinner at the West End Cooker with a new OSI executive and his wife. After the meal, we went to one of Nashville's dance barns. It was a tourist trap that specialized in couples dancing. We did not do the two-step, so we just watched. The executive was in his late 30s, and he was already feeling his three-beer buzz from the cooker. Janetta and I were only 20 years old, a biographical fact lost on the intelligent, yet on the way to Margaritaville yuppie, and his equally intoxicated wife. They started buying us drinks. Stop. Let me rephrase. They started buying me drinks. Janetta didn't drink. Yes, city life and executive friends had its perks. The electronic rooster crowed at 6:30 a.m. the following morning. A wave rolled through my stomach as soon as I opened my eyes. I was nauseated and about to lose it right there on our gray and mauve comforter. "I'm calling in sick today," I moaned. Janetta was in the bathroom applying her makeup. "Get your butt out of that bed, you little illegal alcohol-drinking Yankee." Her words giggled as she ran out of the bathroom into our bedroom, leaping from the bathroom door threshold towards the bed like one of those flying squirrels you see on the Animal Channel. "Don't," I objected, but it was too late. Her small 100-pound body landed squarely in the middle of our bed, took a good bounce, and landed right on top of me. She squealed and laughed the entire time. "Get off me," I grumbled, feeling the need to throw up. "I don't like you after you've been drinking," she complained. I didn't blame her. She was right. "Me either, but can you lecture me in a minute?" I said while running into the bathroom to bow at the porcelain throne. Gross. West End Avenue is backed up with traffic. No Shell Station coffee this morning. I would cut across Centennial Park, pick up Charlotte, head east over to 18th Street, head south one block, a quick left through Chicken Shack Alley, and I would be in the parking lot. ETA, 9 minutes. Commuting in city traffic was an exercise in dynamic logistics. The concrete ramp leading up to the back door at OSI was covered in ice, and I was wearing new Johnson & Murphy wingtips. They were slick as snot. I almost broke my neck twice before reaching the door at the top of the ramp. I was through in one piece. Whew! There was Randall buzzing around S&R, singing, smiling, and doing his thing. "Good morning, Randall," I greeted him. He returned a hearty, "Good morning to you, Mr. Mike." "Hey, Randall," I said, walking towards him as he worked. "You got a minute?" "Sure, man. What you got?" Randall turned and shook my hand. "I have some Bible questions that I would like to ask you about, and I was thinking that you might let me take you to lunch today. I have several service calls in the LNC Tower, but I could swing by around noon. Do you want to go?" Randall held up one finger as to silently say, "Hang on." He then hustled over to his desk, picked up the phone, punched the line, and said, "Sir, can you hold for another minute, please?" He thanked the person, punched the hold button, and put the phone back down. "I'd love to go to lunch with you," Randall said. "Are you driving or am I?" he asked. "I'll drive. Pick you up here at noon," I said, and we went our respective directions for the morning. I could not wait to talk to Randall over lunch, but I reminded myself, don't drink the Kool-Aid.